lives, Lord. Even thank you for the answered prayers, O God. Indeed, Lord, you're the God who hears us and answers our prayers, Father. We thank you, Lord God, Lord, for everything that you have done, O Lord God. Thank you for the strength, Lord God. Thank you for healing, Lord, those who have having chemotherapy, Lord. Thank you for a good response, O God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are our healer. Thank you for answering, Lord, for the immigration papers of our family friend, O God. Thank you, Jesus, for traveling mercy. Thank you, Father, for provision for all needs, O God, financial, physical needs. Thank you for open doors for work, O God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we pray, O God, that we continue to bless, O God, your people, Lord. We pray for the prayer, Lord God, for children and grandchildren to serve you, O Jesus.
What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. give up praise, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. Can we worship you, church? What a wonderful, most beautiful name the Lord has. For his name is Jesus, the one who saved us, the one who died on the cross for our sins. He is deserving of all worship. He is deserving of all praise. Let's not stand here and thank the Lord. He is deserving of all worship and praise. We worship you, God. We worship you, Jesus. Let's not stay silent, church, and worship the Lord.
What a beautiful name it is, the name. But no, sometimes that's how life, our life is, you know? It's this maze that we have the start and this end. And it's not like every single path leads to the end. Sometimes we go through this maze, take a wrong turn, and it's like we have to go back, we have to recenter ourselves, and we go until we finally find the end point, right?
Okay.
And sometimes that's how it is with our life with God. You know, God has this path for us, set forth for us. It's to start and to the end. And yet sometimes we go our own way. We decide to deviate from the path, and we go take a right, and we take a left, and then we hit a dead end, and we're like, oh my gosh, how did I get myself in here? You know, and it's, and we have to go back, we have to recenter ourselves with God, and at the end, as we keep on going through these bumps, through these wrong turns, and in the end, we go with God, and we find our end point with Him. It's just this whole path, and our life is like that, just going through this path, going through bumps and ends, but in the end, we always know that we end up with God. So this is what God wants for us to be, to go from the start, to go to the end in His will, in His path, in His direction. So today we're going to study about how to know God's will. How do I know this? How can I, you know, eliminate these different bumps that I go on in my life? So, you know, and it's hard because we have to replace our trust in God. And if you see in Proverbs 3, 5 to 7, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all ways acknowledge Him and He will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes, fear the Lord and shun evil. We really, really have to place our trust in God. He's the one that knows the end. He knows the path. We're the ones that need to trust in Him to reveal the path for us. So if you want to act wisely, you want to have a good future, we need to start acting like it. We can't take it light. Since we know that a lot of times our decisions we make, we feel sorry for it later on. Like, oh man, I should have never made it. That's why we should go to God and always seek His direction, because He's the one that never makes mistakes, and He always chooses us to give all the good things in our life. Know that God has a plan for you and a purpose for your life. And that's found in Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, right? Declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. We know this. And we sometimes proclaim this to our hearts, and we really need to live it out in our lives. We need to be very expectant in God that He will do great things in our lives. And oftentimes we ask ourselves, what does this mean now? What is God's will for my life now that we know that He has a plan for us? What do I do? Are my decisions aligned with the will of God? How can I tell? Let's go study what the will of God is. And I want us all to turn to Romans 12:1-2, because I'm going to be really dissecting these verses for us. So if we all turn to Romans 12:1-2, we're going to start reading the Word of God. And here, in these verses in Romans 12:1-2, we see that Paul not only describes or instructs us what God's will is for our life, but also how to live our lives according to the will of God. What we should do. So let's look at Romans 12:1-2. I'm going to read it. It says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Verse 2 goes on and says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. So let's go verse by verse, and I want to start in verse by one, because verse 1 really tells us about our spiritual act of worship. It says, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. The aim of that first verse is to tell us that our life is to become a life of spiritual worship.
Amen.
We are called to be worshiped. We're called to live lives that worship God and give God all the worship. Worship is not just a Sunday morning session with God. It isn't a once a week thing. He calls us to live our whole life. Our lives, everything about us has to be given up to God for worship. It's awesome to praise God on Sunday morning, but it's also to praise God throughout the whole week. It's even better. It's even better to praise God throughout your month. It's even better to praise God for the year He's giving you. Worship is so much more. It's giving your whole body, everything about you, your heart, your mind, everything should be given up to God. That's your true and proper form of worship to God. It's not just a one-day thing. It's a daily way of life. This means that there's a way to live that shows and expresses your love to God and a way that doesn't. So if there's a way to live that worships to God, then we need to go away from that way that shows us that we don't worship God. Let's live a life that worships with God. So how do we live this life? If we continue on to verse 2, it says, Paul explains, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's the verse 2a. So how do we live this life of worship? It tells us that Paul's answer to God to turn our life into worship is that we must no longer conform to the patterns of this world. Meaning we as human beings tend to conform, right? He says do not conform is because we tend to do it. And we tend to not worship God in every single aspect of our life. So Paul says, stop conforming. But how do we do this? He gives us an answer. He says, we need to stop conforming so that we can be transformed through the renewing of the mind. Now, the mind is a very powerful thing. We have to be transformed in that sense, because transformation is not just an external thing. It's also how we think, how we feel, and our mind. It starts in the mind. Transformation begins in the mind. So, have you ever noticed a lot of your battles, a lot of your struggles begin where? It begins in the mind. You already psych yourself out. You already think you're the worst person ever. So a lot of the struggles that we have is happening in the mind. People can't see it. The decisions we make, the things we do, has already happened because we've already thought about it. It's not like when if I punch somebody, I'd be like, I don't know what's happening. My hands are have its own mind. It's hitting somebody. You know, that's silly. It doesn't exist. We've already thought that we were going to punch somebody. We've already thought that somebody did the worst for us. Everything happens in the mind. And so we have to be really careful that God tells us that we cannot conform, we cannot do these things. We have to be renewed in the mind constantly through God. So, yes, the mind is a powerful thing, and this is why we have to protect it. We have to put on, you know, if you know the armor of God, the helmet of salvation. Knowing that God has saved us, we need to protect our mind, that we need to be able to see what comes into our mind and be able to take away from it and dispel it. So yes, our mind is a powerful thing. We must protect it and we must renew it daily with the Lord. Living a life of worship begins through transformation in the mind. So yes, so we are transformed. We all know we're transformed because God has called us to be a new creation, right? In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. So yes, we know this. A lot of times we proclaim that we are a new creation. Yet, we cannot just proclaim that. We have to live it out in our lives. Transformation is not something we say, it is something we live out in our lives. So yes, we must become what we are. We are a new creation, but let's become it. Let's show God how it is. It's easy to say we're a new creation, saying it does not make us, right? We have to act it in our lives as we have to put on our new self. Put it on. Colossians 3:10 says, and we have to put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of the Creator. You see that word, put it on. We can't just be like, I'm a new creation, and we're not living it out, we're not putting it on constantly in our lives. Nobody will put it on for us. Who's going to put it on for us? My mom can't put on this for me. Right? We have to go through God, and God is going to be the one who renews our mind daily with Him. So yes, we are all the new creations, but oftentimes we've seen this, that we've accepted Christ, we've become a new creation, we've given our lives up to Him, and yet we're walking with our old ways, with our old clothes, and we're like, a new creation, and we're in rags. God doesn't want that for us. God wants us to have a complete transformation, a complete renewing every single day. We have to continuously be putting on new clothes. I hope that every single day you guys put on new clothes. You're not using the same one as last week, right? Not the day before. No, we are constantly putting on these new clothes that God has given us. So yes, you know, God... In God, we have to be renewed daily with Him. We are a new creation, and this is something that we have to continuously work with Him so He can continuously renew us every day. We cannot go back to the old ways of life that we used to be living, even though sometimes it's easy because we lived in that so long in our life. Yes. Know that through God, through the strength of God, we have to put it on daily with Him. So yes, Paul explains in Romans 12:1-2 that we have to live our lives to worship God, to give Him all that we have. It is continuously done by renewing our minds to be able to not conform to this world. And Paul explains that transformation in our minds is in Christ. It is done and is necessary so we as Christians be able to discern what the will of God, His good and pleasing perfect will. And that's the end part of that Romans 12 verse 2. It says, then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. So He describes His will as being good, pleasing, and perfect. So let's look into that. Let's go deeper into that. And we're going to start looking as to what it means. Because Paul uses these words to describe what the will is. It's good, it's pleasing, and it's perfect. So the first thing to describe is it is good. So now the word good comes from the Greek agathos, which means something that is good in its character, it is beneficial in its effect. It is good because it comes from God, whose essence is goodness, and His objective is to give us His best. If you remember in Genesis, God created what? He created the heavens, He created the earth, He created the ground, the rain, the rivers, the stars, He created everything. And what does he always say after he created? It is good. It is good. He created us and we are good. God, you know why? Because God gave his best when he created everything. He's always about giving the best. God gave the stars, the moons. Isn't that the best you can give? When you battle how big the world is, God gave his best. God is for excellence, you know. And God gave us his best. God is for us, and he inscribed his best as his excellence. We know that by following God's will, we know that we continue, that he will always give us his best and most excellent path for us. It's beneficial for us in every single way. It builds our character in Christ, and it made us to be good. He made us to be good. So we need to follow the will of God, because guess what? It is awesome. It is excellence. That means as our lives, we need to live lives that are also excellence. In everything we do, and every single path we follow God, we have to be excellent in it. Because God gave his best, that means we have to give our best in our life. So yes, God's will for your life is good. It is excellent. It is the best that he could have done for you. That's the first thing he describes as will. The next one is described as pleasing. So the word pleasing means it is satisfactory in us in all aspects. God knows what we like, and according to that, he will choose what's best for us. It's not always what we want, but God chooses what's best for us. We shouldn't fear to trust God, since he knows us more than we know ourselves. And he will always give us his excellence. And some people, you know, it's hard for them to give up, you know, what they want and desire to God, because sometimes, you know, it's not exactly what they think it's good or not. And I love this place, because when I first became a Christian, I always thought, oh my gosh, should I become a child of God? Because, you know, sometimes in life, that might not be the most exciting thing, or I'm not really gonna like the things that God is gonna have in store for me. And I'm so used to the things of me doing things my own way that, man, this is a good life I'm living. And when you go into Christ and you have given all these responsibilities, at first you might think, oh man, yeah, you know, I was kind of right. But, you know, as you continue to go on with Christ, it's really a renewal of the mind. He changes your thought process. He changes the way you think. And the things that you no longer thought you liked, you're now enjoying. As a singles ministry, we once started this Camilla's house, and we were there for cleaning every Saturday morning. What child, what kid wants to go on Saturday morning to clean somebody's stranger's house? And it was dirty. If we all know. But throughout the process, God is there continuously renewing your mind. If you follow God in his path, guess what? He's going to change your way of thinking. And now every single Sunday, we're doing the next one. Because it is something that became pleasing to us. Not because what we were doing, but because what it was for. When you go into God's path, guess what he's going to make? He's going to make it pleasing to you. Sometimes you have to give up your desires, and it may not be exactly what you want. But know at the end of the day that being in God's will, you're going to love it. It's going to give you joy. You're going to be able to do what God has called you to do, and it's awesome. Right? So God's will is good. It's the best we could ever do in our life. It is also something that fills us with joy, because it's awesome. It's pleasing to us. And next, he also describes it as being perfect. Wow, perfect. Can everybody say perfect?
Perfect.
You know, perfect comes from the Greek term, which means equipping us to realize the real purpose of our existence. With this, we can understand by doing God's will, we will develop our maximum potential and will be fulfilled. God's will is perfect. It is not flawed. It has no missing piece. If God's will for your life is perfect, then you know that it has no missing piece. What are we afraid of to go in God's will? Why are we afraid? It's perfect. There's no missing piece. It's not flawed. It's where we want to be at. His plans for us, guess what, will never fail. They will never be flawed. We will never be missing any piece of information. God knows everything. We're the ones that kind of have to trust in God to know that his will is good for us. You know, and everything we do is always for the glory of God, for his perfect will. You know, and sometimes following his will, although it seems pleasing, seems awesome, it's hard sometimes. And it's not always going to lead us to always be smiling. Because, you know, through trials and temptations, this is part of God's will too. We go through trials. James 1:2-3, it says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, that whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that they're testing your faith, it produces perseverance. You know, the will of God will produce trials and temptations in your life, but it's only to produce perseverance in God for you. It says, consider it pure joy to have trials and tribulations in your life. Do not be discouraged because of the trials that you face by following Christ. It's part of your walk. Be filled with joy instead. And it says in Romans 15:13, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So yes, today, let us know that God's will fill us with hope, with peace, and with joy, and then knowing that we have to trust in Him. So yes, God's will is good for us. It is pleasing, we're going to love it. And it is perfect, there's no missing piece in it. That's it, God's will is perfect. There's nothing to be added onto it. It's already done. So, how do we know God's will? How can we see that in our lives, you know? In order to understand God's perfect will, it is necessary to take several steps that will confirm God's purpose in our life. So, the first thing, hey, I must die to my own will in order to do what God says. So the Lord has gifted us with free will. In other words, He enabled us to decide. Now it is necessary that I die to my own feelings, my own liking, my old ways, in order to submit myself to His will. We should now be willing to obey Him in every single step of our lives. And this shouldn't be creative pressure in your prayer. You shouldn't be able like, oh God, this is what I want. Can you please do it for me? No. We should be always being God. Whatever will is, let it be done in my life. Because it is already perfect. So yeah, in Luke 9:23 it says, then He states to all of them, whoever wants to be my disciples must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Are we not disciples of Christ?
Amen.
Amen. Now in Jesus' time, the cross was a symbol used to literally describe the death of Christ. What Jesus was telling His disciples was that when He said that, is that they must carry their cross daily, or that they must die to themselves, or that their fleshly desires must be put to death. Putting to death their own plans, desires, and turning their lives to Christ with Him daily. This is worship. You gotta give your all to God. You gotta put to death your old ways of thinking, your old way of thinking, your old way of doing things, and give it up to God. And this comes daily through renewing your mind. Putting to death your desires so that you can desire the will of God. And it says in Luke 14:27, anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. As disciples of Christ, we must carry our cross daily so we can seek the will of God in our lives. And we've given this perfect example of what it means to, you know, really follow God. And we know that God gave His best, gave His all for us. He gave His life so we can live to the fullest. And in verse Matthew 26:39, even though it's not easy, we always have to call for strength from His Father to do His will. Matthew 26:39 says, going a little further, Christ, He fell with His face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, make this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as You will. Jesus was 100% God, and He was 100% man as well. As He followed the will of His Father, He knew that His Father's will would lead Him to His death. A death that would give us hope, that would give us life, that would give us a future, that would give us everlasting life in Him. And at the moment He called His Father, as hard as it was going to be, His response was, yet not as I will, but as You will. Jesus followed the will to the Father, and He gives us the example of what it means to die to your own self and do what God has called you to do in your life. It doesn't matter if you're scared, we have to find strength in God to persevere and do what His will is for us. If you ever wonder if you're ready to pick up your cross, consider these questions. Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means losing some of your closest friends? Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means alienation from your family? Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means the loss of your reputation? Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means losing your job? Are you willing to follow Jesus if it means losing your life? We need to die to our desires to do these things, of doing things our way, in order to submit to God's will. He will give us what's best, though it may not necessarily be what we want. We should trust in His will and understand that His decisions are much better than ours. He always gives us the excellence in our lives. So yes, first, as hard as it may sound, we must die to our old ways. Seek God and follow His will in every single aspect of our life. Obey obedience in Him. And I know sometimes it's hard because we live so much in it that we live our lives doing our own way. But we know that if we want to be a disciple of Christ, we have to carry our cross daily, giving up everything to God. So that's the first thing. Second thing is seek God's counsel through His Word. Psalms 119:105 states, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. The Bible has the answers to each and every one of our needs. It could be economical needs, our sentimental needs, where we're going to go study, what needs do our family have. The Bible has the answers to all of this.
Amen.
We should come to the Word of God to seek what it says in respect to our petitions, our needs. If what we are asking for is within God's will, the Word will confirm it. If you do not know the God's direction, ask God for wisdom, and He will give you abundantly without reproach. James 1:5 says, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. And oftentimes we'll say, we do not know what to do, I do not know what to do, I don't know what to do, but yet we're not calling out to God. We're not praying for him for wisdom. Lord, help me in this decision. We're just saying we don't know what to do. We have to know that the Word is the one that leads our path, that gives us our straight path. We need to know that if you want to ask for wisdom, you can ask it to God. You know, search for Bible verses according to your need. God will take care of speaking to your heart. God uses His Word to speak to you. Since the Word has the quality of getting to most of our intimacy, discerning the thoughts and the intentions of our hearts. You know, the Word is active, it's alive, it's powerful. Hebrews 4:12 says, for the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even the dividing soul and spirits, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitude of the hearts. The Bible says the Word is alive. It is powerful, strong, alive, active. We have to use it against all evils. When things go into your mind, use the Word of God to dispel these things. That's what it means to continue to be being God, to read His Word, to be your mind renewed in Him. Because we have to always align ourselves with God and what He would want for us. God uses His Word to speak to us. Looking for the Word will help us follow God to do His will that He called us to do. So seek God's counsel through His Word. Ask for wisdom. The Word is a powerful tool that we need to start using. Third part, gives the desire to do His will. God gives us the desire to do His will. Philippians 2:13, for it is God who works in you to will and act according to His good purpose. One of the aspects that will confirm if we are moving according to God's purpose or God's will is that He will incline our hearts to do His desires. Because He loves us, as the Word says, He does it according to His good purpose. We must submit our desires to the test of time. If you desire something, you submit it, and yet it goes away, like nothing ever happens with it, then you know it wasn't from God. Because it says in Psalms 33:11, but the plans of the Lord will stand forever, the purpose of the hearts throughout generations. We must submit our desires to God, and let God act it out according to our lives. If it's not from God, don't worry, He will dispel it from your life. But if it's it from God, it's going to be there. He's going to have a plan for your life. It's going to go through. And as Christians, we need to stand the test of time as well. Being a Christian is not a one-day thing, once-a-week thing, or once-a-month thing. Being disciples of Christ and seeking God's will is not something we do today on a Sunday and skip it tomorrow. It is something we must do daily. It is a daily walk. We must walk it out in our lives continuously. And how do we do this? We got to pray for strength. Our strength comes in prayer. We must continue to pray and continue to seek the will of God. And we've got to be careful that our prayers don't turn out to be, Lord, do your will, but please let your will align with my will. We should pray, Lord, do your will, and let my will align to yours. It's always us aligning our wills to His. Because we have a will too. We have the ability to choose. But we have to make sure that we're aligning ourselves with God, and not the other way around. God does not align with us. Amen?
Amen.
So yes, lift up your desires to God. God will fulfill it in your life if it's part of His plan for you. And you'll see that. Because things that you lifted up to God and it wasn't walked out in your life is because it wasn't from Him and it wasn't what God desired for you. So last part that I'm going to be talking about is God puts peace in the heart to confirm His will. Philippians 4:7 says, and the peace of God which transcends all understanding will guard your hearts, your minds in Christ Jesus. One of the signs that we can trust to know if we are in the will of God is the peace that He brings to your heart. It is an internal peace in regards to decisions that we are about to make and surpasses our own understanding. God puts peace that's in our hearts and removes all doubts and brings trust and assurance. Now, I want to talk about this peace because a lot of times we think peace and we think like, oh, relaxation, we're at the beach, we're tanning and we're relaxing and this is the peace that I'm talking about. And yes, that's peace, that's good that God gives you rest. But what about when things are going bad and you're having financial issues and you're struggling and you just don't see that light at the end of the tunnel? And yet somehow, without your understanding, you're still filled with this peace that God has given you because you know that He has held you in the palm of His hands. That is the real peace that God will give you. You know, it's easy to have peace when things are going well. But what about when things are going bad? God will give you peace. You know, our walk is not always easy. And yet, if we're able to walk through God, even through our troubled times, God will then give you peace even through the hard times. And it's knowing that, wow, even through this hard time, I know that God is there for me. He's giving me this peace. And that's when you know you are in the middle of God's will. God doesn't want us to be chaotic, that when bad things happen to us, we go off scattered around and we start going our own way. No, God wants to continue to give us peace and keep us together. So, and we know this because in our lives, when, as students or as parents or as families, if we cheat in school, if we don't give our best at work, at the end of the day, are you really filled with God's peace? There's always the Spirit, the Holy Spirit inside you saying, no, you should go back. You should not do the things you do because that's not what God has called you to do. But when you study, when you are good stewards of your work, of your family, when you always continuously be there for them, what else can God fill you with His peace and His love and His goodness? And that's what I want us to know, is that God will put peace in your heart as you continue to do the will of God. We must do everything and give it to the excellence. Proverbs 16:3 says, commit to the Lord whatever you do and your plans will succeed. Let's give up everything to our God. All our plans, any things that we might have decided in our lives, let's give it up to God. He is the one that will give us peace in return. We must commit our lives to the Lord. We all experience when there is something that is not aligned with God and we do not give our best, that we're not left with this peace. You know, it's kind of troubling in our hearts. So we got to do the opposite. And it is the Holy Spirit that will confirm it in us. We need to go back and do our best. Or next time we will have to change how we do things. But when you do the will of God and you give your best, you give all your worship, He will give us a peace that surpasses any of our understanding. You know, and that's what the Holy Spirit does. It works to the depths of our hearts and puts an internal feeling of confirmation or denial. He will give us a deep conviction if we're doing things that are not from of Christ. You know, we have to always be in the path that God has given us. And at the end, He will give us peace. So yes, as I end the message, I really want to encourage you guys that God has a plan for each and every one of us. God has willed a purpose for each and every one of us. Although we all might be called for a different task and different walks, it all leads to the end of worship, glorifying God for who He is. One thing we have in common is that we are all tasked to do a similar thing. We are all tasked to spread the gospel. That's one of the tasks we all share together as a congregation. We have to share the word of God to others. God desires that we spread the good news to all. Salvation is open to all. We have to live our lives of worship. How can we share the news of salvation if we're not living a life that's saved, if we're not living a life that's victorious? A life that, you know, that we're able to give it all up to God, that we're able to deny our own desires so that we can follow Him. We have to live lives of worship, giving our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God. And guess what? God is constantly renewing us every single day of our lives. Today, let us pray that God will transform us, renew us, and give us wisdom and revelation to know what He wants in our lives. You know, sometimes our life is like a puzzle. We can't see the complete picture. We're just trying to fill in the puzzle pieces. But God is the one who created the puzzle. He's the one that knows what it looks like. The puzzle doesn't change. It's already laid out. And if we try to do our own way, we're never going to solve this puzzle that God has called us to be in. We're never going to solve it on our own. We have to take the time to seek God, to follow His will, so we can solve this puzzle that God has called us to. And it's a daily life. We're not even close to finishing. It's a daily life we do every single day. We're putting in new puzzle pieces every single day. It is our job to allow the Holy Spirit to work in us, not quenching the Holy Spirit, but denying our fleshly desires, so we let God order our steps. For me, for once, it's not an easy thing to follow God. At all times of our lives, we struggle, and I understand that, because I've struggled through my life. But being in God's will, knowing that God is there for us, knowing that God has a plan, knowing that God has a future, knowing that God will prevail for us in all situations, that's what we live for. And it's hard because it's when we go away from God and we know it, and we start putting on our own clothes, and we start condemning ourselves, we forget that God is always there for us. He loves us no matter what, and that we have to continuously just seek Him. He forgives us, and everything is good in Christ.
Amen.
So yes, today I just pray and continuously pray that God will give you peace, that God will instruct you in whatever God has planned for you in your life, and that God will continuously to strengthen us. But we must seek God in every single aspect of our life. We must give it all up to God. So today, let us pray. Lord God, thank you, God, for your message, Lord. Thank you, God, for your will. It is perfect. It is good. It is pleasing for us, Lord. You've created this life for us to be lived out according to your will. Something that is excellent, awesome, Lord, that you've described it as being good, just as you created this whole world, created our bodies, created everything about us. Lord God, thank you, God, for giving us this life, Lord, that we can follow you, that will give us peace, that will give us love, that will give us everything we need. Lord God, call upon today for your strength, Lord, for your strength to follow you continuously in our lives, for strength for our family, for strength for our co-workers, for strength for everyone we come across to, Lord. May they get to know you, Lord. May they get to know your will. Lead them, Lord. Lead their path straight to you, Lord God. And as your presence, Lord, just falls on us today, Lord, we give you thanks, Lord. With thanksgivings and praise, we worship you, Lord. Use us, Lord, mightily for your calling, Lord. As bodies, Lord, sacrifice up to you, God, giving you every single aspect of our lives, giving up to you, Lord, so that your will be done, so your word can be spread across the nations, Lord. You will use each and every single one of us, Lord, for your will, for your calling, Lord, to bring your people to Christ, Lord. Take away these old clothing and continuously put us in new garments, Lord, garments of praise, Lord, garments of goodness, Lord, garments of just be here with you, Lord, God. Lord, we give up this time, Lord. We will never ever have a moment like this with you, Lord, to proclaim your goodness, Lord, to seek your will in our lives, Lord. And today we just pray, Lord. And Lord, I know that each and every one of us have our own concerns and our own trials and tribulations, Lord. But today, Lord, let us all come and seek you, knowing that in turn, if we give you all our problems and all our tribulation, Lord, and in turn, you will give us peace. You will give us love. You will give us rest. You will give us grace. You will give us faith to do your will. Lord, as I end this message, Lord, I thank you, God, for your goodness and all that you do in our lives. You are so great, the Lord of Lords, King of Kings in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Well, we're going to prepare our hearts today because the Bible says in Nehemiah, if you can just share with me, open your Bible to Nehemiah 8, if you have your scriptures with you. You know, for the message, thank you, Stephen, and thank you, God, for your message from the pulpit. The Bible says in Nehemiah 8, it says, all the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring up the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. Verse 2 says, so on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought out the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from when?
Daybreak
till noon. That's a long time, is it not? He faced the square before the water gate in the presence of men and women and all those who could understand, and all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him stood Mattithiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, Maaseiah, and on his left were Pedaiah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hashem, Hashbadana, Zechariah, and Meshulam. Ezra opened the book, and all the people could see him because he was standing above them, and as he opened it, all the people stood up. Well, today this is exactly what we're doing. We're opening the Word of God because there is no revival that happens without the Word of God. And the intention of the Word of God, as it rightly divided by a person whom God has taught, to study the Word, is for us to be able to respond to it. And in a little while, we will allow for the Holy Spirit, even now as He is doing, to open our hearts. God is uncovering us every time we hear the Word. The Word of the Lord is described in the book of James as what? A mirror. Imagine if you fix yourself without a mirror. Half of us would look funny. Our eyebrows would be on our forehead. Our hairs would be split the wrong way. A mirror is not to rebuke us, but rather to make us look in the image and likeness of our Lord, as it confirms in the Scripture. Stephen's message today is about the will of God. It is the will of God for us to return to Him. The message of the Lord today is, the will of the Lord is for us to return to Him through Christ, the only door. In the book of John 8, it says, He is the door. His shepherd hears His voice. He is the door. There are no other door that could lead us to the Father except through that door. He is the door. The great thing about that door is there's freedom. He says, so you can come and go. It's not a license to sin, but there's freedom, the grace in the Lord. Today, we would like to open this for our hearts to be softened in the Lord. We studied this and studied His Word. There's no specific instructions here for us to know in terms of your daily living, except in principle, God says, A, He loves you. B, His Word gives you His assurance of His lordship and love for you. And this is the place when you feel the tug in your heart, you cannot see it. That's the Holy Spirit saying, it's time to come back. And in the same chapter in John 8, there was a woman found in adultery. Imagine that woman dragged out of the bed with the bed sheet still tangled over her body, dragged by men. When we uncover our sins, it is sometimes to destroy us, but when the Lord uncovers us, it is to restore us back to Him, because when He uncovers us, it is for Him to cover us with the blood of His own Son, to restore our dignity, our identity, and His lordship and fathership over our lives. This is the will of the Lord, as we have heard today. We will lift this up in response through prayer. Prayer is the other power other than the Word of God to communicate to Him. And you know what prayer is? It is an expression, as Stephen said, of our intimacy with God. There was a guy who was praying, and his English is all over the place, discombobulated grammatically with the prepositions, the subject and the verb all over the place. And the lady beside him became very indignant to say, how dare you pray such a prayer that confuses me? And the man says, unfortunately, I was not praying to you, I was praying to God. And thank God for that, is it not? That we can pray to God in all transparency, because this is what connects us to Him. And I hate it when I cry because it gets in the way of the message, but this is the point that I'm trying to say today. If there is a tug, it's not of human persuasion, but it's of the power of the Holy Spirit. There is not a time that we are touching the hem of God's garment, as the Bible says, where healing flow. And every time we pray, we are touching eternity. Understand that when we collectively pray together, we are touching eternity. If you are here and you are not yet square about your relationship with God, here is His message. He loves you. His Son died for you. You do not need to cover yourself with leaves, just as Adam and Eve did when they discovered they were naked. They sewn for themselves leaves to cover them. No, it's the blood of Jesus that will cover you. And will give you an identity, the Bible says, that says you are God's own. He is not the God whom we serve. He is the God in whose we are. And there's a difference. We may not be perfect, but we're certainly forgiven when we belong to Him. Every time you hear yourself condemned to say, how can you call yourself God's when you still sin? Well, it's the grace of God that allows us to go on each day. And let me give you the good news. In the book of Revelation, where God is revealed in Christ Jesus, every church that God spoke to, they were not perfect. The book of Ephesians says the church of Ephesus, but He still called them His church. Is that not good news? He says to the church in Ephesus, you forgot your love, but He's still their His church. To the church in Smyrna, this is it. To the church in... You know what? In all that, I found great encouragement to know. No matter what I do, as a mess as I am still His church. In other words, I am His bride. He will not leave you nor forsake you. And so as we rise up on our feet, may I ask you humbly before God to stand on our feet so we can open this. This is the threshing floor. Remember that woman who was dragged out of her bed with the bed sheets and all, condemned to the accusation that she was an adulterous woman before? Jesus was very quiet as her accusers were accusing her. He was just writing on the sand. Whatever it was he wrote on the sand quieted her accusers, because one by one, the Bible says, from oldest to the youngest, they dropped the stone that they were going to stone her with. I wonder, like I said on Friday, if what he wrote on the ground were names of women that they also had adulterous relationships with. Because it is not for us to judge each other, but rather it is Jesus. Jesus who did not judge us, but offered us this amount of time to just come back to him. Just as with the woman in the alabaster jar, who poured out her love, because the Bible says, Jesus said, she loves me so much because she understood she was forgiven with a lot. Every time we understand we're forgiven with so much, that is the birth of worship. That is the will of the Lord for us. We are living in perilous times. There is no such a time as like this that we are surrendered to God. Look at our surroundings, our society, the changes in leaderships of every country. But no matter who leads the country, it is still the God of the universe who is sovereign over all. And this is the same God in whose we are. That's the difference. We belong to him. The safest place on earth is in the will of the Lord. And this is the will of the Lord for us. If you've already committed yourself to the Lord, then join us in just worshiping God. The altar is open for anyone. If the Lord has moved you right now to just come and pour out your alabaster jar, listen to the word of Jesus to the woman who was accused in an adulterous relationship. Jesus said, where are your accusers? And she says, I cannot find them. They all left. Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Do not listen to what condemns your heart. The Lord welcomes you. He said, neither do I condemn you. Go. There's freedom. And sin no more. There's the grace. In the Lord, we can go and sin no more. He would not have instructed that if it were not possible. It is possible to live in the grace of Jesus. If you're here and you have not received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the same altar is open. Not by human persuasion, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. Come, we welcome you. If you are here and you have left for a while and you feel like it's such a separation between you and God, you cannot feel, well, here is the time for us to just embrace and return. His arms are wide open. With the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray that he will cover you with his blood, not by persuasion of men, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. For this place ceases to be a location. We are touching eternity every time we pray. And I ask those of us who are leaders in this church, servants, serving the Lord, to come help pray for those that step forward. If you are in a place right now where you're celebrating the goodness of God, well then release that into someone else so that whatever your seed is becomes your harvest. And lay your hands over, the Bible says, or those of you sick, call the elders of the church to lay hands and pray over you. Are you happy and rejoicing? Then worship him. Because this is the word of the Lord for us today. You are my own, you are my own, you are my own. I will not leave you nor forsake you. And Father, to those that have stepped forward, I release the power of your Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Healing and health be released over to our brothers who have stepped forward calling for health. To those our God. You're our Father, oh God, who loves your children. We bless you. We give you praise. In the mighty name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Use your people with your blessing, God. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to call Ronnie. Come, thank you for coming forward. We will continue with our communion. As this day, we will celebrate the Lordship of Jesus in us. He's given us instruction to do communion.
So communion. Communion is important because it's a command to remember. Jesus wants us to remember every time we taste bread and wine, and even when we sit at the table in our own homes, that He is the one who provides all we need. He gives us the physical food that we need to survive and the spiritual nourishment we need to keep taking next step with Him. So today is a communion Sunday. As we prepare our hearts to partake in the communion among fellow believers, we may keep our minds to the reason for our communion, that as often as we do this, we proclaim His death until He comes. So, you have the elements already? Let us stand. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11 says, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is my blood, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Please partake. In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." Please partake. Drinking from this cup declares the return of our Lord in living in His strength and the covering of His name. Thank you. Lord, thank you, Lord God, for your life, O Lord God. Thank you for dying for us on the cross, so may we have life. May this blood and body of yours, Lord God, will be in our hearts, O Lord God, so that we remember you, Lord God, every time of the day, O Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Please, we ask and pray in Jesus' name.
Oh, what a Savior.